Viewers, welcome to my channel IITJ Olympiads and AP Physics with Ambarish. And today one of my students asked me a very nice question from Kruto, so I thought I'll just do a video solution on that one. And so here's the question in the Olympiad workout series, Kruto 1.49. So let's look at the question. So the question says that a massive disk rotates about a vertical axis at an angular velocity capital omega. So this is a massive disk and it's rotating with angular velocity capital omega. Okay. A smaller disk of mass small m and radius r, whose axis is strictly vertical, is lowered on the first disk. Okay. The distance between the axes of the disks is small d. Small d is greater than small r. And the coefficient of friction between them is mu. That is, the coefficient of friction between the smaller disk and the bigger disk is mu. Determine the steady state angular velocity omega of the smaller disk. What moment of force m must be applied to the axis of the larger disk to maintain its velocity of rotation constant? The radius of the larger disk is capital R greater than d plus r. The friction at the axis of the disk should be neglected. Now, Krutov language stops just at this full stop. And students are left wondering what exactly is happening and why should this disk rotate. I mean, it looks like the bigger disk rotates and the smaller disk will just stay put on that. And then why should there be an omega of the smaller disk relative to the bigger disk? Now, if you look at the solution and you try to rack your brain on it, what exactly the question means, you will come to know that what is happening is that even though this disk is lowered onto the bigger disk, but this disk is not allowed to rotate around the bigger disk. Its axis is fixed with respect to ground. So it can rotate about the vertical axis, this vertical axis, and this vertical axis is fixed with respect to ground. So that's why I have added the axis of the smaller disk is fixed with respect to ground. So that's the real meaning of this question. If you look at the solution, you'll come to know that this is the real meaning of the question. So if you want, you can try out this problem, but let me tell you at the outset, it's a very tricky problem and it's about making some intelligent guess, you can say, at the solution. I mean, let's get into the solution. You can try it for some time and then look at my solution right after this. So, okay, so let me get into the solution. So let's look at what's happening exactly. Let's look at the dynamics of the problem. So consider this is the smaller disk that I have drawn. I have not drawn the bigger disk. Just consider that this is the smaller disk and the bigger disk is rotating with capital omega. Okay. So what's happening? Suppose the disk is lowered, the smaller disk is just lowered, then every point of the smaller disk is having zero velocity. So how will the friction forces act? So the point of the bigger disk just below this point will be moving in this direction relative to the smaller disk, right? The smaller disk has zero velocity. So one friction force will be acting on this point. And consider the diametrically opposite point of the smaller disk. On this one, the friction force will be acting perpendicular to this dotted line, okay? So this is the F2, okay? So this is the F1 and this is the F2. Now, you might be wondering why should this smaller disk rotate? Because consider the arms of these two frictional forces. I've considered diametrically two opposite points. And what is happening to the arms of these two frictions? So you see this friction is acting like this. And it has perpendicular distance from the center as L1, okay? And this friction is acting like this and the perpendicular distance from the center is L2. Now you can clearly see that L2 is greater than L1. So that means what? Frictional force, the counterclockwise torque is more than the clockwise torque. All right. So F1 is a clockwise torque, but a smaller arm. And symmetric points I have considered, small patch of area you might imagine, just for imagination's sake, small identical patch areas, but causing different torques. So that's why this disk is going to rotate. All right. So that's what I've written. So observe that L1 is less than L2, so the disk experiences a net anti-clockwise frictional torque about O, so and begins to rotate with an angular velocity in the anti-clockwise direction until the frictional torque becomes zero. And the direction of friction will change. Once the smaller disk begins to rotate, you know that the friction will act in the direction of relative velocity. So initially, this is at rest, so these are the direction of friction. But once it begins to rotate, the direction of relative velocity will change. So the direction of frictions will also change. So now let's see what's happening. Now suppose at some instant the smaller disk has angular velocity small omega, okay, and the bigger disk, again not shown in the figure, bigger disk has, let us say, capital omega. So what's the velocity of this point? Let us say P dash is the point of the bigger disk and P is the point of the smaller disk. So these are two coincident points, one below the other, okay? So P dash belongs to O dash, I mean this, the bigger disk, and P belongs to the smaller disk, okay? So what's the velocity of P dash? That will be capital omega cross R1. Okay, R1 is this vector, okay, from the center of the bigger disk to the point P dash. Okay, so that is omega cross R1. And what's the velocity of P? That will be small omega cross R1. Okay, so what's the relative velocity? So relative velocity is nothing but the subtraction of the two. So capital omega cross capital R1 minus small omega cross small R1. So that's the relative velocity of the point of the bigger disk relative to the point of the smaller disk. Okay, so this is V P dash P, and this is also the direction of friction. Okay, now I want to know when will the frictional torque vanish. So it's a matter of thinking very carefully and trying to imagine what's exactly going on. So let's just think of a scenario. What happens when small omega and capital omega become equal? If small omega and capital omega become equal, what happens to this expression? So this is capital omega cross R1 minus, if small omega is also replaced by capital omega, so this capital omega cross R1 minus capital omega cross small R1. So that becomes capital omega cross R1 minus small R1, right? Capital omega cross capital R1 vector minus small R1 vector. Now this looks familiar theme. You have done this in finding magnetic field in the cavities and in finding electric field in the cavities of a sphere. You are familiar with this expression, and it leads to a constant vector, right? So capital R1 vector minus small R1 vector is nothing but the vector joining O dash to O. So this is O dash O vector. Now this is becomes very interesting. That means what? If small omega is equal to capital omega, the velocity of this point is perpendicular to O dash O, right? The relative velocity becomes perpendicular to O dash O. And it's independent of the choice of point on the periphery. Why? Because the capital R1 minus small r1 vector is independent of the choice of point on the periphery. So all these vectors are perpendicular to the O dash O vector. So everywhere, you know that. Now since the relative velocity is in this direction, so everywhere the frictional force becomes in this direction, perpendicular to O dash O line. So it's a like uniform frictional field, if you want to call it, just like a uniform gravitational field. So that's the kind of frictional force field that you will get if small omega vector is equal to capital omega vector. Now once your frictional force become uniform, so just like uniform gravitational field, you might as well fix the frictional force at the center, okay? And you know that the torque of the frictional force will become zero about point O because it's a uniform frictional field, right? So that's that leads to our answer to the part one. So what will be the steady state omega? So that's the you get small omega should be equal to capital omega, because all friction vectors become perpendicular to line O dash, causing zero torque about O, and that's what you get. All right, now coming to the one more part is there. What is the torque required to keep the bigger disk going with a constant omega? So now that part is also very simple. So if you see on the bigger disk, on the smaller disk, friction forces are acting like this uniformly. So the bigger disk will get just its reaction. Okay. So in this direction, friction forces are acting. So I just need to apply a torque to balance the torque of the friction force on the bigger disk. And all these frictional forces can be concentrated at the center of the smaller disk. So so you can say that the frictional force torque will be what? So this distance is small d, and the value of frictional force is mu mg. So the frictional torque that's acting is simply mu mgd, and I just need to give a torque to balance the frictional torque. So what's the required torque? That is mu mgd. So that's our answer to the second part, and I hope you all enjoyed this video solution. And if you did enjoy the video solution, please do subscribe to my channel if you've not already subscribed. And please share this video as much as possible with students who are preparing for Olympiads or IITJ Advanced. And please do give it a thumbs up. Thank you very much for watching the video. That's all for this video, and see you in the next one.